So Call Me Dad then, as well as the ABC Commission, also then kind of participated in this and received some additional funding, mostly to kind of run an outreach campaign, which is to kind of basically work with organisations to kind of host screenings and use it in educational settings. You know. So it's being used in the police force, in correction services, in prisons to train other counsellors with kind of tertiary training for other kind of, mental health issues, that sort of stuff. That's sort of where it was aimed at. And of course, in a kind of general sense, it was going to go out to a broad audience through the ABC. So that was all looking really good at that point, until, of course, it's never really very smooth. We lost access. So we pitched this documentary, kind of pretty much we were there. We had contracts with the organisation that was hosting us. We had contracts with the ABC flying around. We had good pitch money kind of hanging over us. And then suddenly there was a management change in the organisation that we were working with, the middle management change, and they changed their minds. They didn't want a documentary crew in there filming, you know, editorially independently to the organisation. The person that the new manager that had come in hadn't been introduced to the project very well, and we just not really from us from within internally the organisation. They just said, look, we're really sorry, but we've changed our mind. We can't do it. So they like, all right, so then what we did was we thought, well, we'll start again, still on $5,000. We'll find another group and do it again. And it was really difficult, actually, because we wanted to find a good group and a really good counsellor. Like, we wanted to show the potential for this this process. It's a pretty difficult one anyway. Like, it's not guaranteed to work, and it only works, you know, it works under certain circumstances when it's well done. And so we looked and looked and looked and looked, and we just ended up not being able to find one in Sydney that really we felt was a good vehicle for a whole set of reasons. So we found a group in Melbourne after a lot of trouble, and we had to do this very quickly too. And then we had to re-pitch it back to the ABC and say, look, we've had a problem with our group, but we've found another group that we think actually is just as good and actually better, and actually we did think it was better in a weird way, even though it was like tremendously stressful. In the end, actually, I think it worked for us, and luckily the ABC liked it too. So this is the new group. It was based in Melbourne in a suburb called Pakenham, and this group had two counsellors, had a male and female counsellor, and we did basically the same process of, kind of working out how we would work together. Essentially, they ran they run 20-week courses. It's a weekly thing. The men come for one night a week. They offer a parallel group for the women, so if the women choose to, if they're still with their partners, the partners can also attend a women's counselling group, which we didn't feature in the documentary, although it's part of a little small part of it. And I think actually it's a phenomenally good part of the work, actually. So one of the things about this group that we really liked was that Melbourne has been doing this kind of counselling work for longer. Victoria's kind of a leader in lots of ways in sort of social issue stuff. And they have a peak body down there that's kind of done a lot more research and just sort of has a better framework, probably, and which is possibly going to kind of move through Australia, actually, with a set of minimum standards that their groups work to. And this group was a part of that broader umbrella organisation. So in the end, as stressful it was losing it, we did actually kind of get through somewhere. So, and that became Call Me Dad. That's like kind of our last piece of publicity for the program. And I'll pay you the drug.
And we got married 12 months after that. And then, you know, we got pregnant. And then she said, I'm scared of you.
I can hear the yelling going on.
He was like a bomb waiting to go off.
I'm going to try and get some help to you now.
I've been doing this for the last 15 years. Literally work with hundreds of men.
Happy family, real happy family doesn't exist. It's a fucking myth.
Don't expect me to change that at all.
I'm in a lot of holes. People at the bar, my wife.
Hi, Dad.
Hi.
Hi.
Why do I have to put up with this? You hear me? Why don't you pack up and leave?
What brought you guys to this group was this type of behaviour.
I'm not an idiot. It's a survival mode.
How much did you have to drink before tonight?
I Hey, Susan, I know it's tricky.
What happened? Did you fall at school? Is it not there to hit me?
We've made a report to child protection.
We've got to be realistic. The abuse might not stop.
Take it easy, just sit down. Get knocked off your bike, you get back up and get on it.
This room should be filled with hundreds of people. You guys are the ones here that made the commitment to be different.
Everything that's happened, totally my fault.
I can understand why she has. Where's her rooms?
Strength isn't about muscles. Strength is about being the best person you can be.
She's not strong. I'm hoping I'm a dad again.
Twice in the ABC, we ran quite an extensive political campaign. Really, we did parliamentary screenings in Canberra, Melbourne, New South Wales, and Queensland. We also worked with corrections who have kind of incorporated it into their training for their staff, including their prison officers. And there's some thoughts about showing prison population too, but that needs to be managed quite carefully because it's, it can be quite, you know, triggering stuff. And so I guess we've handed over to their expertise actually to manage that kind of process. And I guess, and we ourselves kind of worked with a counsellor on the program to help us kind of manage the participants' exposure to being part of an observational documentary about their lives and to put some framework around like ongoing support for those people. So we've continued with counselling support for any, on request, basically, for any of those men and that, all women who feature in the documentary, or really anybody around it who wanted some support, but primarily it was a few people that would feature in the documentary that we've kind of continued in touch with. And how long is the piece? Oh, so we've got a feature version, which is 80 minutes, and a TV version, which is 57. It's an ABC hour, 57 minutes. Yeah. And we also kind of had a professional education writer as part of the Good Pitch sort of write a kind of a screening toolkit so that there's sort of quite an extensive kind of set of ways you can engage with the film in kind of a public and educational setting.
Yeah. In a documentary like that, mm-hmm. you get the permission from the actors or the fathers
yeah.
to do all this.
Yes.
And how informed can that be?
Yeah.
It's a problem, is it? Do you put in the credits their names as well?
No. No, very good question though. And we had a lot of discussions, long discussions about that and tried to put a little brains trust around the project. So we had a consultancy, they were non-editorially enabled, they weren't allowed to limit from that. We didn't give them editorial control of the film because the ABC maintained editorial control, but we put together a brains trust of people who were counsellors in domestic violence, Karen Willis from 1-800-RESPECT, who's kind of the national hotline for, and she's an advocate for domestic violence issues with women, a professional psychologist, and some of the organisations that kind of run counselling programs. So that was kind of our brains trust. And so we showed them cuts of the film as we went along to actually kind of get their sort of feedback on it. And broadly, that was part of, I guess, like protecting everyone, you know?
Yeah.
Protecting the participants, protecting us as the filmmakers, protecting ABC, you know, that we had a broad coalition of partners that were kind of engaged in some oversight. Largely, we went away to make the film, but we would kind of, we set a framework up of from the beginning with the participants, which was that, I mean, the way we recruited them was just once the organisation was interested in us being there, we held a few kind of information nights. We said, look, there's no commitment. You can come and ask questions and never talk to us again. Or you can come back for the second information night and we'll talk a bit more about it. And at some point, if you really aren't interested in participating in this, we'll talk really seriously with you about what that means. And that will involve signing a release form. So we gave them lots of notice about that there would be a contract. I mean, releases are not worth that much, but that there would be something that they would sign that would give us the rights to kind of distribute this material publicly.
When you're dealing with something like this, it's an element of a family.
Yeah.
Do you have to get releases from the whole of the family? Because, I mean, obviously, you know, like this person is going to be seen on TV, everyone's going to know the rest of their family. So, how do you go about, I mean, do you show children at all?
We didn't show children in a kind of a identifiable way, except for teenagers, there's some teenagers, and their relationship. There wasn't violence towards those children, it was sort of like the mother and father had a relationship broken down and separated, and they were kind of, everyone was like safe, you know. They also didn't have to participate either. Like, people were, not all the women wanted to participate. It was very much like, if you don't want to participate, that is completely fine. We are not going to push you at all.
Yeah.
But with the men, we did need enough men to participate in that process so we could actually watch the counselling really happen in real time.
Yeah, and you wouldn't have been able to use anyone that's sort of kids were under a family court.
No, you can't. It's a very particular legal thing too. You can't publish details about family court matters. So people who had family court issues, it wasn't appropriate for them to come and be a part of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
And if some people fell into those problems, we had to not film with them.
Yeah.
There were whole storylines that we just didn't pursue because it was just not legal or appropriate. Really.
Surprisingly, I still had a therapeutic effect on those men, seeing themselves later on.
Well, you know, it's interesting because we did show the film to them at a kind of between a fine cut and picture lock. Again, we had to be really clear that we couldn't edit things that they didn't like because undoubtedly there would be things that they weren't very comfortable with. But we did, I suppose, our kind of pitch to them was, look, we'll be really honest with you about what we want, you know, and you can take yourself out of this if you need to, and we actually support that if it's not safe or appropriate for you to continue being filmed, that's okay with us too. But we do need your genuine commitment to this, and we do need you to kind of, at a certain point, say, okay, I will sign a release form. And from that point, that is a commitment. We make a commitment to you. We will be here every week and we will sign this and we will be honest and we think truthful about your situations and compassionate and not judgmental, but we'll be truthful and we can't step back from that. And I think that was kind of like, well, look, it's kind of like, we want you to do this and we think there's value in it and we think you will help people by participating in this. But it's not for everyone, you know?
I
didn't mean to hijack into this, but it's an excellent question. The release forms are like kind of at the beating heart of the documentary.
This is actually a question about funding, just very quickly.
Yeah.
So I'm presuming then that in terms of you could get that brain trust in place, and actually the ABC have ticked off and said, we accept. So at that stage where you only had the $5,000, you and your co-producer had an enormous
investment of
research and no expertise on board. You just had to basically persuade and on the basis of the argument you just put. And that got a key point. Yeah.
I mean, I don't think there's any... People participate in documentaries for all kinds of reasons, and the men and the women that participated in this documentary, to us, did it from quite altruistic reasons. Like, the men had already some exposure to the counselling and had found it helpful, and they're like, look, I know this helps me, and I know other guys like this, and I think this would help them, so I'm prepared to do that. It's a particular cohort of men you see here. They weren't extremely violent in the kind of spectrum of violence. Like, these were people who were clearly violent, but there is sort of spectrum of behaviour, and they felt in a kind of a more moderate form. But I'm not meaning to diminish what they were doing.
I'm being pragmatic here, trying to work out how your commitment in terms of your hours, which obviously weren't.
You
paid.
Vomit hours into development, and
you
never get the money back.
That's
what happens.
You had $5,000, and you had how many months of work till you got ticked off?
Well, we submitted in June in 2013, and I think we got they turned it around in about 6 weeks. They said, yes, we're interested, shortlist, show us something. I think around November we'd kind of done the first casting reel, and then we lost access, and then we found access again by about March the following year, and then we went to production a bit after June. So it was like a year door to door by the time we actually kind of hit the ground running with the camera in the real group.
Did more funding come in at that point?
Then you get your production funding drops down, so everybody kind of gets in a huddle and they throw contracts around, and then eventually kind of everybody agrees, or it just gets so exhausted they go, okay, enough, we'll just fight it.
So basically you get that
$5,000 paper cuts. Yeah, exactly. And
So basically you work for $5,000 and children you 3 years.
Yes,
yeah.
Pretty much.
So the $5,000 is largely irrelevant. You've got your foot in the door with a chance to actually get it funded.
Yes. Nobody pays you for development really.
Yeah.
They give you a small token amount to make you feel not too bad.
But it's a stamp, isn't it?
Yeah, and it's kind of a commitment from the broadcaster. Yes, we put money in it. It's actually important just to drag
it
money out of it.
Developed by the ABC.
Yeah. And a big part of the ABC also gave us a certain amount of, prestige, but you know, like if we'd gone into and said we're from the Lifestyle Channel or something, I doubt, you know, like there would have been a much more a bigger sense of anxiety about it. But the ABC, they're kind of, oh, yeah, like,
and that outreach stuff, is that also part of getting the stamp of approval for access?
No, that came afterwards.
Okay.
That was completely separate to it. yes.
Okay.
So
it comes with a good pitch, doesn't it?
It comes with a good pitch. You kind of, because we were selected for good pitch, there were, like, you run a kind of parallel campaign of reaching out to specific audiences that resonate with your film or can be helped by your film, in which case we were interested in, you know, kind of shining a light on domestic violence, encouraging politicians to put more money into it. There was a Royal Commission happening at the time and there were recommendations coming down, of which Call Me Dad became part of the evidence for the Royal Commission in Victoria, and they actually, one of their four key recommendations was to increase funding for men's behavioural change program, and so on. Rosie Batty kind of, you know, hosted one of our screenings. So it was a sort of coalition of partners that came in to kind of raise awareness around this. You know, essentially a single film, it's quite small really in its footprint, but we've just tried to amplify the message and add weight to the other campaigns that have been running around domestic violence in Australia. We also got in Gogglebox, which was really great. And then now it's I looked at some interest from a production company in the UK, so we're sort of in development, unpaid development, again with an organisation from the UK, because the UK actually has some really interesting work happening there around men's behavioural change groups and quite a lot of research and stuff. So so that'll be fun. I'm a fan to Victoria, but I was just going to say, you know, don't give up. It's really good to do. There's one other. I'll show you one other thing, if you like. How much time I have? I can show you something. Like, sometimes you don't get things up. You know, it happens to all of us. We were talking about this last night. I was going to show you something else, but maybe I'll show you something I've never got up. I've been pitching it for years, and I cannot get it up. And so I will show you, because you are now my audience. Possibly the only audience I will ever have for this job.
Anybody can tell you. You see the fire coming out of a diamond. It's there's nothing quite like it. A diamond is an absolutely beautiful stone, no comparison. Always go 10 cans a day. It's good business. You want to be a diamond dog?
The amount of minerals that are right on this west coast has been worth billions and billions and billions of dollars. And yet, the communities are impoverished. That makes sense, huh? It's basically third world.
There's Silver City, and there's Rainbow City, and there's the White Rocks.
They have pushed us out. We cannot continue doing this. We cannot. The price is too bad.
All you can do is hope. Feel it. If you can actually get out and turn something over.
The dark side, other side of the light. The dark side becomes the corruption, the manipulation, the intimidation. And then
the local leadership in their lives has been putting off the level of their poverty. Always the case of corruption. There's always money going missing. We're not talking about small change, we're talking about millions.
The light side is the future. The upliftment, the interaction we have with the people.
The finances that are generated through endowments must come back into the communities.
projects, they come. Sometimes they're beautiful ideas. It's not your fault. You have to move on sometimes, I guess is the other one. So,
what if it changes though? Like, what if that whole town, like by the time someone wanted to do it?
Bad luck for me. Yeah. That's one of the reasons people here yesterday said, I said to you, like, I wasn't going back to West Africa and spending my money, like, filming stuff anymore after this project. I made a decision, all right, I'm just going to have to do it from Australia because I just can't, you can't kill yourself on development. You have to actually kind of find smarter ways to work. And on the surgery ship, I did it differently. I found archive, I shot people in Australia, I cut it in a way that was differently. And that project got up. So look, I don't know, there's no real justice in it, is there? That's it.